What means the School of London?
The School of London is an expression that Kitai used in a catalogue text for a 1976 exhibition he curated for the Arts Council titled The Human Clay. And in this text, he very much speaks in relation to the work he brought together. They were mostly works relating to the human figure. And in this text, he says there are a number of artists working in London at the moment and working with the figure whose importance and the quality of the work of them is so great that it's only comparable to the School of Paris at the beginning of the 20th century or the School of New York from the 1940s. In a way, he very much wanted to give visibility to a type of work based on the figure that at that moment was not certainly seen in all its greatness because the cultural artistic landscape was primarily promoting, of course, art which was abstracted or conceptual, that had a relationship with across the Atlantic. And so School of London becomes this term that gives a strong visibility and presence to this type of work that, of course, will acquire much more importance and will be critically recognized fully from the 1980s, 90s.
Kitai himself, he came from the States to London. Bacon came from Ireland. Freud and Auerbach, they came from Germany. But all these people, they met in London. London, after the Second World War, was one of the last avant-garde towns, let's say, in Europe. So what was London for them, or what is London for them? Because some of them are still alive.
Yeah. Yes, certainly London at that moment in history is a very important place culturally, in the sense we have lots of emigre artists who come from Germany, Poland and elsewhere and meet and start working in London. We also have individuals like Bacon who decide to make London his home because of the sort of lively atmosphere of London and the possibilities that the city gave, or other individuals like Paul Arrigo, who comes to study in the 1950s and then returns to develop their career there. There is a sense certainly of London being an extraordinary meeting place for individuals from different cultures and backgrounds, and one where there is a sense of developing a practice alongside one another. Kitai again said, you know, we didn't really work together, but in a way there was a sense of excitement and looking at each other's work, and there was a sense of pushing one another because we were all working in a way that was different but similar, certainly in the engagement with painting and looking at painting across centuries.
London seems to be important for them, at least in two aspects. One, the relation teacher-pupil, so this means the academies, the schools, and another, the museums. The National Gallery as a place to know, to copy, to study the masters. Can you tell us something about these two important places, schools of art in London, museums in London, and how relevant have been for all of them?
For sure, in terms of school, we certainly have, and we can see from the beginning of the gallery, two very important figures who were important artists in their own merit, but also important teachers. William Coldstream, who was teaching at the Slade and became professor of painting there from the late 40s into the mid 70s. One of the very first painters he hires to work there is Lucian Freud. And among his students and then teachers in the school are Michael Andrews and Ian Uglow. And you can see a certain shared sense of attachment to drawing and also this very analytical gaze, particularly in their early work. And of course, Paul Arrigo also started at the Slade in the 50s. The other sort of important figure as a teacher is David Bomberg, who would teach at the Borough Polytechnic between the late 40s and the mid 50s. And among his students were Frank Auerbach and Leon Kossov. Many of them would go particularly to the National Gallery, but also to the Tate to draw from pictures by important masters. And these included a great variety of painters from Velázquez to Picasso, to also Turner and Constable when it comes to landscape. So there is always this sense of engagement with the work of important artists from different centuries.
Francis Bacon is a key figure in this group of artists, but Pablo Picasso, so far as I know, have been shown in Britain very early, and he was very influential, not only for Bacon, for Francis Bacon, but for all of them. Mm-hmm. What do you think about this?
Yes, certainly Picasso was very present in terms of exhibitions in commercial galleries and particularly at the Institute of Contemporary Art from the late 40s. He was very known by all of these artists, but also they referred to their work and they knew their work in other ways. So for example, Bacon famously lived quite a long stretches of his life in Paris and particularly visited in the late 20s. And he said that it was his encounter with Picasso's work in 1929 that really made him wanting to begin painting. So it was a huge influence in terms of even the origin of the work. And certainly in this particular painting, we can see it very clearly.
This is one of the, let's say, great works in your collection. Can you tell us something about this situation that Bacon offers here?
Yes, this actually is the second version of a painting that Bacon made in 1944, and it was exhibited for the first time in 1945. It was hugely influential when it was presented for the first time in April that year. It very much resonated with the climate of anxiety of the immediate post-war period. And later on, Bacon decided to make a new version. He very much was so close to this painting and its importance. And so it is in 1988 that he decides to make a larger version where we have even more, a greater sense of space and this darker red and this continuous presence of these figures that in a way haunted him, of the Furies, which were of course these important mythological figures.
Two plans from Lucian Freud. It took him 3 years to finish this painting. Why so long?
This painting was made at a very important moment when Freud changed studio. And so he was very much painting this scene of a corner of the garden of his new house and studio in a way to become used to the new space, to the light and the condition of the new site. He didn't make many paintings of exteriors, but there are a few. And there is this sense, of course, again, of intimacy and closeness of a side that was very near to him and that he knew very well. And again, there is this sense of capturing change over time. He's painting a scene over an extended period of time where plants were growing and decaying, and life and death as are depicted as cyclical and co-present. We have this new bits of plants that are growing and stemming from the old plants while others are decaying and dying. It's a very sensual and delicate representation of the cycle of life.
Paula Rego is the only woman, the only painter who is included in this exhibition. So it seems that the School of London was not very sensible maybe to woman artists, but we are very glad that you included her work in this exhibition. And she's still working, hardworking, and I would like to know maybe a little bit more about her relation to art history or to literature. I mean, she's an artist who interprets history in the same way the history of the woman, but at the same time the history of art in her way. Mm-hmm. Velázquez, William Howard. Mm-hmm. What you can tell us about her specific and original way to make interpretations of what the other artists made in the past? Because somehow she's a little bit grotesque maybe in the way how she deals with history.
I think certainly what is specific about Rego, but not exclusive of her, we can see this in Kitai too, is that while with the other artists we see more an engagement with the tradition of portraiture and landscape or cityscape, with Kitai and Rego we really return to these large, important compositions and history painting in a way. It's not anymore looking at traditional historical narratives or allegories, but they are contemporary allegories of modern life. And in terms of her own references, she certainly very much was always very interested in storytelling and the importance of fairy tales as sort of gateways for understanding the way we interact as human beings. but also in the paintings of his important masters, who very much, of course, had history painting, a large composition, as the best and most important part of their practice. So, of course, she was also one of those artists that would go and refer, certainly from the late 80s, to paintings in the National Gallery particularly. And we have here examples that resonate very much with Velázquez, for example, and these very complex narratives where different figures in the painting relate to each other through the gaze, through mirroring, and so forth. So, yeah, she's certainly very interested in these historical examples.